The Pennsylvania German Hour is underwritten by the Pennsylvanische Deutschversammlung von Bodecks County, the state's largest annual Pennsylvania Dutch language gathering, traditionally held the first Monday after Easter in the Leesport Auction Hall. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the West Berksversammlung, held annually on the first Saturday in October. The Pennsylvania German Hour is also brought to you by the Rentschler Leib family and Reverend Richard Miller and family. The Pennsylvania German Hour is a production of the Nye Dolpahock Sanger Corps, the regional Pennsylvania German choir specializing in traditional and contemporary dialect music for the heritage language community. The Pennsylvania German Hour is produced in cooperation with the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, the hub of Pennsylvania Dutch language and culture. Contact us at 610-683-1589 or visit us online at www.kutztown.edu/pgchc. Mir zauwe gross dank zu alle unser Gucke, Unterstützer und Freund. Gute Maria, liebe Gucke, und willkommen zum Pennsylvanisch Deutschstunden, der Beschblatt für Deutschzuhörer auf BCTV. Heute ist der 2. Dezember 2022. Und Winter ist schier gordo, und Grischdog ist just rummes Eck. Aber gebacht, bis bald ist der Belschnickelumkommer für die Kinderfroa, ob sie gut oder schlecht wore des Jahr. On December 3rd, celebrate Pennsylvania German Christmas traditions and the vibrant folk culture of the region at Christmas on the Farm at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. on December 3rd. Christmas on the Farm is a free, fun, and educational event for the whole family featuring folklife demonstrations, live musical performances by some of the region's finest folk musicians, kids' activities, animals, local folk artists, and special appearances from the legendary Pennsylvania Dutch holiday visitor, the Belschnickel. Also open during Christmas on the Farm is the new cultural exhibition entitled Mountain Mary, Contemporary Visions of the Sainted Healer, exploring the life and legend of Mountain Mary, Anna Maria Young, immigrant pioneer, farmer, and sainted healer of the Oley Valley. This exhibition features new works by contemporary artists and historic artifacts from the Oley Valley, and the exhibition is located in the newly opened Delight E. Breitigam Building, headquarters of the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center at Kutztown University, located at 15155 Kutztown Road, Kutztown, PA, 19530. In tandem with our new exhibition, today's show on BCTV will feature a presentation on Mountain Mary's colorful life and often contradictory legend, both of which continue to embody the traditions and positive values sustaining the region's folk culture. Today we'll be exploring the life and legend of Anna Maria Young, also known as Mountain Mary, sainted healer of the Oley Valley. We're doing this today in tandem with a brand new exhibition that just opened on November 16th, at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center, entitled Mountain Mary, Contemporary Visions of the Sainted Healer. Throughout 2021 and 2022, we commissioned works from local artists and asked them to explore the story of Mountain Mary and find aspects that spoke to them as artists and through their own artistic vision to present Mountain Mary as Mountain Mary continues to be relevant to new generations today. We see some very traditional and some non-traditional presentations of Mountain Mary in this exhibition, all of which highlight different facets of the Mountain Mary story and the Mountain Mary legend. Now, for many people in the region, we know a little bit about Mountain Mary, but the fact is, the more you know about Mountain Mary, the more you know that we have very few certainties, the more we know we don't know about the Mountain Mary story. Mountain Mary is best known locally as a woman who lived in the Oley Hills, who lived for roughly three decades by herself as a farmer and also as a healer in the region. This presentation today is going to highlight several other significant aspects of her life through the lens of primary sources, some of which are public documents, some of which are documents that Mountain Mary signed herself. And these include the four different facets of her life and legend that we present in the exhibition. Her as an immigrant pioneer, as a farmer and entrepreneur, and as a healer and herbalist, and ultimately as a venerated saint following the time of her passing. This image of Mountain Mary is the earliest known depiction of the Mountain Mary story, and it comes from a book written by Ludwig August Vollenweber. Vollenweber was a newspaperman from Philadelphia who ran the German language newspaper, the Philadelphia Democrat.
And his book, Die Berg Maria, Treu bis in den Tod, in English it's Mountain Mary, Faithful Unto Death. This book was capturing the story of Mountain Mary through the lens of the American Revolution. Part of the reason that Wolin Weber looked at Mountain Mary in this particular way is the fact that his book was produced just a few years following the American Centennial in 1876, when interest was very high in presenting aspects of unique American narratives dating from the time of the country's founding. Wolin Weber was a first-generation Palatine immigrant who settled in Philadelphia and was very proud of having immigrated to America and was very eager to connect with the immigrant stories of other German-speaking people who settled in and around Philadelphia and the broader southeastern Pennsylvania region. Wolin Weber brought his knowledge of Palatine German to an understanding of Pennsylvania German. However, one of the things that he was very eager to do was present these stories by filling in some of the details. So he depicts Mountain Mary in ways that are not consistent with her biographical story. For instance, Wolin Weber depicts Mary as an orphan, having attempted to cross the Atlantic with her family. Her family dies on the way, according to Wolin Weber's story, and she meets Theodore Benz, a man that she would eventually marry, according to the Wolin Weber narrative. Theodore Benz is also an orphan, having come across the ocean in order to try to find a new life in Pennsylvania. Wolin Weber also introduces some significant historical figures, such as Henry Melchior Muhlenberg, who is the father of the Lutheran denomination in North America and the organizer of the church. He's depicted in this illustration here, where you see Mary and Theodore and Henry Melchior Muhlenberg on the deck of the ship. He helps them to find places to stay in Philadelphia and to find work, to help work off the cost of their passage. He also eventually, according to this story, presides over their wedding on the dawn of the American Revolution, right before Theodore goes into the military to serve in the Revolution. And later, Mary is a distraught widow after Theodore Benz passes away. And it's Henry Melchior Muhlenberg who helps to find her a place to stay in the Oley Valley and suggests that she might take up healing as a way to deal with a grief-stricken existence. The problem with this story is that Mary is often secondary to the roles of not only Theodore Benz and Henry Melchior Muhlenberg. She's a person who oftentimes is not necessarily determining her own story, but someone whose story is determined by others. And we know that the story of Mary is actually quite different. She was never married. We also know that she had no Revolutionary War husband. She also had taken up healing and lived in the Oley Valley, not alone, but with members of her family who did make it across the Atlantic with her. And so the story is fundamentally different than how Wolin Weber presented it. We know that Mary was not an orphan, but rather she arrived with her family, including her father and her mother and two sisters. The five of them all made it safely across the Atlantic. However, we don't know the precise year of their emigration. No fewer than 15 families with the last name of Jung arrived prior to the American Revolution. It is believed that she arrived sometime around 1765. However, this has never been verified. Now, the interesting thing is, Wolin Weber, of course, created this story out of an absence of information. So he was filling in the details and kind of liberally adding to the story in a way to create a convincing romance about the life of this historical figure. And yet he got a lot of things wrong. He wasn't aware of many of the sources that we're aware of today to help clarify her narrative. And many of the primary sources that we're going to explore today will take a look at Mountain Mary through the lens of her own writing, through her own estate papers, her last will and testament, which she created in 1813, just before passing away. This is Anna Maria Young's signature, and this is how she signed her will in 1813. You'll notice that she uses her full name, Anna Maria Jungin, that I-N being the feminine suffix to formal German names in the 18th century. She's using her maiden name here. Her family's last name was Jung. She was not married. She identifies herself as a single woman and is identified as such in the original estate papers, including her last will and testament and those after her passing. So she was never married. It would have been patently inappropriate during that time period to identify her as anything other than a single woman, because that was part of her legal designation. It wasn't just a matter of preference. It was actually a legal designation. And so when we take a look at some of these primary source documents, we learn a little bit more about her through her own words, through her own signature, and find the ways in which she may have lived a very different life than the legends have suggested about her. We also know one of the most significant aspects about the Mount Mary primary sources is a cryptic entry in the 1790 federal census that depicts Mount Mary as Mary the Abbess. This may be one of the first sources that really helps us to understand a little bit more about her, and at the same time begs many questions of the historical narrative. What did this title suggest? You'll find that this particular entry is on a page for East District Township in Berks County, and you'll see Mary and then in parentheses the word the Abbess. And this is an interesting thing because we generally believe that Mount Mary was probably Protestant. So this word abbess is something that doesn't necessarily fall in sync with what we would have expected from either Lutheran or Reformed denominational language of that time. It was assumed that Mount Mary, being so closely connected with the Hill Church in Pike Township, Berks County, where she lived, it was originally Eastern District, but later Pike Township. We assume that she was Lutheran because of the connection to that historical congregation and its close proximity, but she may not have been. We don't necessarily know. And just because she was affiliated with that congregation doesn't necessarily indicate what her religious preference may have been when she first emigrated to Pennsylvania or what her affiliation may have been in 1790. What we do know from this entry is that the implication is that she had a role as a religious leader within her community. The term abbess being, of course, a female leader of a religious convent. We also know that in this document, it cites that she had three women living with her. And so what we'll find is that there are several other documents that help to corroborate the idea that she lived there with her mother and at least one of her other sisters, maybe two of her sisters. And this is a fascinating thing because you can see the way in which the Mary story starts to take on an entirely different nature than what you'll find in the Volund Weber story. She was not a widow of the American Revolution, and she had family members with her when she got here. There's also another set of historical papers that were published in the 1930s by a woman by the name of Edith White Birch. She was a descendant of Mountain Mary's executor by the name of Daniel Yoder, and many of Mountain Mary's original documents were kept within the Yoder family following the settling of the estate. And several of these are different documents associated with land agreements, financial agreements, things along those lines. One in particular that I have here on the screen is a legal document that gives Mary's brother-in-law by the name of Matthias Motz the opportunity to have first rights on her land if she were to sell the land or if she was to pass away and that land was to go up for sale. And the interesting thing about this document is, again, you see her signature, Anna Maria Jungen. In her own writing, she could read and write well enough to be able to draft her own legal documents. You'll also can tell as well that clearly she's referring to the family of her sister. And in this particular document, you can see the names of her sisters. She refers to them as her deceased sisters in this particular document from 1814. It says, Verstorbenen Schwester, literally referring to her deceased sisters, Katharina Elizabeth and Maria Elizabeth. And this is really significant because now we know the names of the sisters that came with her to Pennsylvania and settled in Pennsylvania with her and predeceased her. And Matthias Motz is also named here as well. And he's named as being her brother-in-law, as her schwager. And so the interesting thing about all of this is that we can start to see from these documents the way in which Mountain Mary's life may have looked a little bit different than how it was originally presented in the legends, and especially those of Ludwig Augustus Vollenweber. There is also another letter that is among these documents from Edith White Birch that includes a letter congratulating Mary's mother, Elizabeth, from a man by the name of Jacob Schneider from Easton. And this letter includes congratulations that you were able to live on some land in the Oley Valley in 1779 with your two daughters. And so it's a really interesting thing that it identifies that Mary and her mother and at least one other sister were living in the Oley Hills at that time. So we have this date of 1779 as being the earliest evidence of their living in Pike Township, Berks County, on this property that would later be known as Mountain Mary's homestead. So there's some very significant things we can learn from all of this. The homestead itself highlights Mountain Mary's role as a farmer and entrepreneur. Here we can see images of both Mary's bake oven and a spring that winds down the mountain where it flows directly into a chase that goes underneath a slab and enters into a milk house. So here we can see the bake oven. You'll see over here as well the spring coming down the mountain, channeled by open logs that had been hollowed out to use as pipes to direct the spring off of the hills. These had been replaced many times over the generations. This photograph was taken in 2009, the last time that these pipes were still channeling this water. So it was coming down and going directly into a chase that you'll see right here, goes underneath the slab, and then flows into the milk house, which is depicted on this side over here as well. The milk house had an area inside of it where the water was maintained so that it could be used for the storage of dairy, and the ambient temperatures from the cold spring water would help to maintain the temperatures necessary to preserve dairy as a form of refrigeration. The most significant primary source for the story of Mountain Mary is that produced by Philadelphia Quaker Benjamin Hollinshead, who visited the Oley Valley in 1819. During the summer, just a few months before Anna Maria Young passed away in November of 1819. The interesting thing about this story is that although Hollinshead does not provide a lot of information about his reason for visiting the Oley Valley, he does mention a couple of significant details. For instance, he mentions that he went to the Oley Valley accompanied by a Philadelphia apothecary by the name of Jesse Thompson. And he went to specifically visit two friends of his, Benjamin and Anne Wright. He mentions a few niceties about their visit and that they also paid a visit to Mountain Mary. And he talks about the visit to her property, the impression that he had of Mary, of her reputation as a healer, and the religious experience of talking with Mountain Mary, who spoke in lofty tones that he describes in his account. One of the things that's so significant about this visit as well is that there's some biographical information about the Wright family that provides a little insight into the purpose of Benjamin Hollinshead's visit to Oley. During the time that he was visiting, Anne Wright was pregnant with a child who was named Benjamin after his father, but also bore the name of Hollinshead as a middle name. Very likely following on this visit, when Benjamin Hollinshead and Jesse Thompson came, likely to provide some form of medical attention or medical care to Anne Wright during the few months prior to the birth of her son. And this is also very likely why they went into the Oley Hills to visit Mountain Mary as well. Now, he doesn't specifically state this in his writing, but Benjamin Hollinshead mentions that while portions of their party explored Mountain Mary's property, he mentions that they come back to a lunch that had been prepared by Mountain Mary. What is unspoken is that there's a period of time where it appears that the men from the party may have explored the property while the women consulted with one another, namely Anne Wright and Mountain Mary. This may have been a visit relating to medicine, and that may have been a visit that required some discretion. So while the men were out exploring the property, the women were in Mountain Mary's home talking and consulting. The interesting thing about this as well is that this is one of the very first accounts of Mary's property. He describes this thriving farm with a dairy herd. He mentions the milk house, which is just a few steps from the front door of her original homestead house. And we also find out that there is a spring that flows, a very active spring. He describes the meadow and many other different aspects, including a cemetery where Mary's mother and two sisters are buried. So this is one of the things that we find within this account. The other thing that we find as well is that he describes her as a healer who was guided by more than human judgment. So already you can start to see the way in which Mary was regarded as being not only a person who was a religious leader, but a person who had a far-reaching ability to work with other people, to have this reputation as a holy person. And if we read the quotation from Hollinshead's account, he says, "She commenced speaking in a religious strain, informing us through a lady of our party who acted as an interpreter that on serious subjects she was obliged to speak in her native tongue, the German. Her remarks breathed a strain of devotional feeling which had a solemnizing effect upon the company, and the countenance of the speaker was one of the most benign I had ever held." This description was written in the months following Mountain Mary's passing, when Benjamin Hollins had returned back to Philadelphia from his visit, and is one of the first descriptions of Mary's temperament, the way in which she was described as having this specific role as a religious leader within her community. And it helps to describe the way in which local people felt about Mary at the time. We don't have very many other contemporaneous accounts describing Mary. We have, of course, these primary sources from her estate papers, a few letters and other things along those lines, but this provides this very lofty description of Mary's effect upon other people and her role within the community. Of course, Hollinshead also describes her farm and mentions some aspects of how she was regarded as having been a productive farmer. And this is such an important thing because it's identifying that she is a woman who lived alone for the better part of 3 decades and ran a farm on her very own. Typically, we think of Pennsylvania Dutch farms as requiring the entire family to pitch in and work together to accomplish just the basic tasks of caring for livestock, harvesting in the fields. And of course, Mary may have gotten some assistance from her neighbors, but we do know that she kept a thriving dairy herd, that she had a profitable enough business to be able to leave behind a significant amount of money to her heirs. The heirs were the descendants of her one sister who moved to New York. And the interesting thing as well is there are descriptions of Mary harvesting hay that she was going to be using to feed her livestock and many other different aspects of her life. These two illustrations depict Mary as being a productive farmer, and they are featured in the Mountain Mary Triptych altarpiece created by Henry W. Sheridan, who is the founder of Kutztown University's art program. And Henry W. Sheridan painted this sometime around 1945. This particular series of paintings depicts a wide range of vignettes of Mary in various roles of her life, showing her settling on her farm, showing her healing her neighbors or attending to the sick, as well as milking cows, harvesting grain, and so many other different aspects of her highly profitable farm venture. One of the most important things that he highlights, aside from Mary's healing in this particular series of paintings, all combined together as an altarpiece triptych, is the fact that she was considered to be a highly productive farmer. This seems to be one of the things that was most admired about Mountain Mary as it regards her story in the Oley Valley. The most detailed description of Mountain Mary's farming operation comes from her estate settlement documents, especially the inventory that was taken of her farm after her death on November 16, 1819. This inventory was taken just a few days later on November 20th, and it outlines a wide range of things that were in the home of Mountain Mary and on the farm. And it provides a snapshot of her life in a way that other primary sources simply were not able to do. many different aspects of her life are documented in this inventory, including her apparel, her bedsteads, two spinning wheels, a flax wheel and a wool wheel, lots of cloth, yarn, things along those lines. There is no loom listed, but there are many other different types of objects relating to the farm. So we know she was processing fibers by spinning, doing her own spinning. You'll find that there are all kinds of different things relating to her livestock. And in fact, her livestock, at this point in time, by the time of her passing, she had only two cows. She had one cow and one heifer that were listed. But she also had sets of cow chains, butter bowls used specifically for processing of butter. They also mention many other different things from the farm, grinding wheels, shingles, a wheelbarrow. One of the significant things about the wheelbarrow is the fact that there have been depictions of Mount and Mary coming from hearsay following her passing, that supposedly she used a blanket that she carried out into the fields and she heaped her hay onto the blanket in order to drag it back to the barn. The reality is she was using a wheelbarrow, and we can confirm this by means of the inventory. Mary had what they would have referred to in Pennsylvania Dutch as en schubkadig bouwerij. A schubkadig bouwerij is an example of a distinctive Pennsylvania Dutch idiom referring to a farm that used a wheelbarrow as opposed to draft animals. And so this was a term that typically implied a subsistence farm or a farm that did not have the same level of investment in draft animals as the average farm that would have been run by many more people and probably would have had far greater resources. Nevertheless, you'll find that there are also in this farm mentions of Mary's beekeeping equipment and her beehives, and this was one of the ways that she was also able to make money, primarily from the sale of butter and from honey. A very significant item included on Mount and Mary's inventory following her death are her books and manuscripts. She made provisions for these books and manuscripts in her last will and testament from 1813 as well, which she planned to give to her niece, Maria Elizabeth Schneider, at that point in time residing in Albany, New York. The interesting thing about these texts are that we don't know what they contained. Were these religious books? Were they ledgers pertaining to her healing practice? Was Mary perhaps a midwife? Could these ledgers give some indication of what types of healing traditions she was using? We will never know. It would be wonderful if these sources would turn up somewhere either in New York or Berks County, because they would shed a lot of light on Mount and Mary's story. Following the visit of Benjamin Hollinshead, Hollinshead asked a friend of his by the name of James Dewey to visit Oley and to collect material on Mount and Mary sometime probably around 1825. It was listed as just several years after his original visit that he asked James Dewey to collect this information. And Dewey's accounts are even more detailed than Benjamin Hollinshead's account. Now, the interesting thing is, of course, Dewey talked to her friends and neighbors as she was remembered by local people. So we can't call this a primary source, but we could say that this was a form of oral history fieldwork documentation. And what you were finding was descriptions of Mary's farming, descriptions of her healing, and many other different details that add to the Mount and Mary story. And one of the things that was so central to this was how productive she was as the operator of a dairy farm, that she had a dairy herd that provided enough high quality milk and cream for her to be able to make cheese and butter and a number of other different products that were taken to market. Now, Mount and Mary was described in these accounts as carrying her cheese and butter down the mountain on her head to give them to one of her neighbors by the name of Isaac Lee, who was then able to take that material to Philadelphia, where it was sold at farmers' markets. And there have been many different depictions of Mount and Mary over the years, building upon James Dewey's description. And one of those is an image that shows Mary here as an older woman using two canes and holding and balancing her dairy up on her head coming down the mountain. This particular illustration was done by illustrator Leroy Gensler, who worked with the Pennsylvania Folk Life Society and the Kutztown Folk Festival in the 1950s and 60s. And this particular image was not only modeled after Dewey's descriptions, but also after some other accounts that were collected in the 1890s in the Reading Eagle that described aspects of her life and her operations. And there was an image in the Reading Eagle at that point in time of a log building showing Mountain Mary's abode, and then also images of her carrying her dairy on her head down the mountain to take it to market.
This image was also likely the inspiration for a contemporary depiction of Mountain Mary by Veronica Ronnie Bakenstow at the Goshenhoppen Historians Annual Folk Festival and at the Pennsylvania German Cultural Heritage Center's annual programs. Although Ronnie no longer portrays Mountain Mary, she recently celebrated her 100th birthday.
James Dewey's account also includes a number of detailed descriptions of her dairy operation, her fields, her meadows, her orchards and gardens, even of the grading of roadways leading up to the property between Mountain Mary's homestead and Hill Church, and down the hill leading towards the Oley Valley. The description was that wherever roadways or pathways were too steep or perhaps too rough, Mary herself would go out and grade them so that access to the area was possible. Mary was also described as having a great deal of kindness for animals. There's a story related by Dewey that groundhogs got into her garden, a large number of them, and she took the pains to trap the animals without harming them, and then carried them over the mountain to get rid of the animals and allow them to escape without harming them. One of the most important pieces of information as well that James Dewey describes is the source of income for Mary. He describes not only her dairy, and also especially that the honey from her hives was one of her primary means of income, as well as bloodletting, which specifically refers to her healing practices. At that point in time, it was very common. Both conventional and lay practitioners practiced bloodletting as a way of being able to balance the humors in the human body, which was believed to effect a cure for a wide variety of different ailments. This was something that a person could also charge for and was believed to be a major source of income for Mary. Of all aspects of Mountain Mary's story, her reputation as a healer is perhaps the most well-known. Although it has not been documented precisely what form of healing Mountain Mary practiced, it is well documented that she attended the sick and brought provisions and other goods from her farm to people who were in need. There is a wide range of different types of healing modalities that would have been common in her time. James Dewey specifically mentions her bloodletting and also herbs, but not much else in terms of actual information is available. One particular work of art that we feature in our exhibition here at the Heritage Center is a piece by Paul Wehan, which has a small vignette of Mary leaning over a person in the act of healing. Of course, one of the aspects of Mountain Mary's healing that was thought to have been central to her narrative is the idea that some people believe that Mountain Mary was a folk practitioner known as a Braucherin, practicing traditional forms of healing among the Pennsylvania Dutch known as Braucherij. This would have been the treatment of human and animals by ritual means through the use of applications of prayers, physical objects, and herbs. And this would have fit very well within both the time period and the culture for Mountain Mary. However, there is no documented evidence to suggest that this was precisely what she's doing. Instead, we're left with the stories that have been passed down over the years. This particular image, taken from a small portion of a hand-printed banner showing Mountain Mary's life by Paul Wehand, shows Mary leaning over a person that she is healing, touching them with her hands. The use of light touch accompanied by prayer is one of the most common aspects of Braucherij healing, also known as powwowing among the Pennsylvania Dutch. And this is precisely what Paul Wehan was depicting here. Paul Wehan was an educator, an art educator. He studied at Kutztown University. He taught in public schools in the Allentown area. And this particular banner was produced as part of a continuing ed seminar that took place one summer under the direction of Henry W. Sheridan, who was also the artist featured earlier in the altarpiece of Mountain Mary. Henry W. Sheridan suggested that the teachers who were participating in this continuing ed activity would get together, produce an image of Mountain Mary that the students from their schools could also assist in the production of. So this particular banner is one of the results of that particular summer institute. Now, the interesting thing about Mountain Mary is that we do have this information that she used herbs. Many folks have pointed to the use of herbs and said that she was practicing more in a clinical sense and that she perhaps could not have been practicing the ritual healing techniques. But one of the things I want to clarify is that for healers from her era, it was incredibly common for practitioners to specialize in a wide range of different techniques, and many things that were even considered clinical in her era, in the late 18th century and early 19th century, would have overlapped with very specific cultural traditions among the Pennsylvania Dutch that involved some ritual components. For instance, I have three different herbs here that would have been common aspects of treatment in the local area. On the far left, we have asafoetida, which is a resin derived from an allium that is very, very pungent in its smell. It was not only used to treat coughs, whooping cough in particular, and other types of respiratory ailments. It was also put into bundles and worn around the neck as a way to ward off illness. My own grandfather from Lebanon County used to go to school with a little bag of asafoetida around his neck when he went to school, and it was believed to protect him from obtaining an illness from someone else. Now, the humor of this is also that for many people who are familiar with this herb, it is so pungent that it would actually, in fact, discourage the transmission of illness by means of people staying away from one another who were wearing it because of how incredibly strong the smell of asafoetida is. The second herb I'm mentioning here as well is elderberry. Elderberry is considered to be antiviral, and the flowers are one of the few edible parts of the plant aside from the berries. The flowers can be used to create an anti-inflammatory tea, but both the leaves and the bark were also historically used as well, both topically as a form of anti-inflammatory. And of course, the berries were also used in a wide variety of ways. Today, many people will use the berries to produce a winter tonic, a form of elderberry cordial that can be taken, and it's believed to improve one's constitution. This is part of local folk medicine still to this day. The other thing about elderberry is that not only was it used as a physical agent, able to be part of a treatment process, but also was used ritually. For instance, in the past, folks would cure gout by tying on pieces of fabric or fiber or yarn to an elderberry tree while reciting prayers, because the belief was that it would transfer their illness, the gout, to the tree. It was also used to cure epilepsy in the same way. The other herb that I want to show up here as well is plantain, known as zij or blader among the Pennsylvania Dutch. Plantain, in this particular illustration, was used not only because it had some anti-inflammatory properties, it used to be used to treat bee stings in order to calm the feeling of discomfort following the sting of a bee or the bite of a spider or things like that. It could be chewed and applied as a poultice. It could also be used to ease sore joints. But in this particular situation, you can see it's been dug up because at one point in time it was common to take plantain root, to bundle it in white muslin, wear it around the neck when suffering from a fever. It was believed that it would absorb the fever into the roots, and then the roots were typically buried in a dung heap or cast upon flowing water, because the belief was it would cast the illness aside, it would take the illness out of the person, and it would either degrade in the dung heap or it would pass away by means of this flowing water. James Dewey's account also includes a number of things that point again in the direction of the possibility that Mary was practicing some form of ritual medicine. The one mention he has for bloodletting is somewhat of a confusing passage, and it's something that has been largely ignored by historians over the years, because the word that he uses to describe it as being one of her practices and one aspect of how she obtained her income, he mentions that she practiced vivisection. Vivisection is actually the word to describe the dissection of live animals. Given the fact that Dewey was also reporting on how Mary was completely unwilling to harm an animal, it is highly unlikely that he actually meant vivisection. It is very likely that the term he was searching for was venesection. Venesection was a late 18th century and early 19th century term for phlebotomy, or the letting of blood that was specifically used for healing. And this is something that would have been common in its day. It was very common that people would use German language almanacs, like those right up here, that show columns for each day of each month, the liturgical calendar that would accompany it, as well as the movements of the stars and the planets. And the lunar zodiac was also identified in this way, with particular symbols for the signs of the zodiac in a column. Those were specifically used to orchestrate activities associated with bloodletting, because it was believed that depending upon what sign the moon was aligned with at that point in time determined the part of the body that one would either avoid or that one would bleed in order to relieve illness. It was a very complex system, oftentimes accompanied by elaborate diagrams that would show the signs of the zodiac and their influence on the parts of the body. Blood was typically let from a small wound that was created by a lancet, and then the blood would be allowed to flow for a given period of time, because the belief was it would relieve toxins from the blood and balance out the bodily humors. And the humors were believed to be the manifestation of the four elements in the human body. So this was an older system of medicine, but one that actually enjoyed a long-standing tradition here in the United States by both folk practitioners and trained skilled physicians in the 18th and 19th centuries. One other quotation from Dewey's accounts of his trips to Oley, however, also leads one to believe that Mary had this reputation as a ritual healer. She was said to be a very intelligent and religious woman and was visited by her neighbors to have her advice on their difficulties, which was often so judicious and far-seeing that she was thought by some to have a way of acquiring knowledge unknown to many. This particular quotation also touches base on an old traditional saying that was common among the Pennsylvania Dutch in the local vernacular. Folks would say, "Sy kan meer brood essen," and this was a way of saying, "She can do more than eat bread." And this term was used to describe a person who was a healer. And in one sense, they were meaning common everyday things, such as eating bread was not the level of a person's skill and expertise, i.e. implying that the person had subtle abilities beyond that. It also includes the idea that many times these healers were believed to take upon themselves the illness temporarily before getting rid of it. And so this idea of eating bread was thought of as being a metaphor in that sense for being able to take on and remove an illness. And this is something that is implied perhaps in this statement from Dewey, where Dewey is talking about having these subtle abilities that are beyond those of a normal person. And we can see the way in which this may have contributed, these attitudes, to the way in which folks thought of Mountain Mary as being a healer who had perhaps also additional powers or additional abilities beyond those of the norm. Mary's connection with the notion of braucherei or powwowing as a form of ritual medicine is also perhaps one of the reasons that Mary was regarded as a saint. There have been other traditional practitioners of braucherei who were called saint, such as the saint of the coal region, Sophia Leininger Baylor, who was a woman from Tremont, Schuylkill County. She was especially well known because folks would call upon her during difficulties, especially when there were accidents in the local mines, which were not uncommon in her day. She was especially well known because it was believed that her intervention using ritual healing over the telephone was what saved the lives of several coal miners who were trapped at the bottom of a mine shaft following a collapse in the mine. At least one of them was bleeding heavily and was thought to perhaps be on the risk of bleeding to death until Sophia Baylor was called on the telephone. She asked for the baptismal name of the person and she said a prayer and used a verse of scripture from chapter 16, verse 6 of the book of Ezekiel from the Bible. And it goes something like this: When I passed by thee and saw thee polluted in thine own blood, I said unto thee, When thou wast in thy blood, live. Yea, when thou wast in thy blood, live. And she recited this over the phone. And the belief was that she saved the life of this miner who was bleeding to death at the bottom of the coal mine. She was considered the saint of the coal regions because this was considered to be a miraculous healing. And this one instance contributed to her overall reputation within the area. She was best known, however, for treating of neighbors and friends throughout Tremont and the broader area as a person who would freely give of her time. She never charged for a single aspect of her healing, but instead it was all freely given. And this contributed to the deep religious reverence that people had for Sophia, and then also for the traditions that she used for the benefit of others, and of course the belief that all of these cures were ultimately in the hands of the divine. Mountain Mary is venerated on November 16th, which is the date of her passage, as with many of the saints and martyrs from the old liturgical calendar. And historically, people would visit Mary's grave both on that day and other times of the years as part of a pilgrimage. Many folks in Berks County would visit the grave of Mountain Mary as a way to pay their respects to this sainted healer, but also an inspiring female pioneer who embodied the values of her community. Dr. Don Yoder, who was the principal founder of the folklife studies movement in the United States, referred to Mountain Mary as the principal Pennsylvania analog to the European saints legend, which developed from the human need to have tangible, visible, human scale patterns embodying the values central to one's society. This was a way in which people could relate to the divine through a human being. And the idea that this person would not only have virtues that were in keeping with the religious traditions, but also the way in which they would exemplify values that would be characteristic of the culture and positive for the community. Mary was especially well known for her generosity, her kindness, her willing to help other people. And this is one of the enduring aspects of her legend. This is also, of course, in connection with Pennsylvania's interest in general in the revival of the notion of a female saint of the wilderness. In fact, one of the earliest mystical communities founded in Pennsylvania along the Wissahickon Creek by Johannes Kelpius in the 18th century, right outside of Germantown, was named the Woman in the Wilderness, quoting both the biblical scripture from the Book of Revelation, but also this notion of female divinity echoed in many other aspects of different religious sects here in Pennsylvania. For instance, at the Ephrata Cloister in Lancaster County, the saint's legend of Saint Genevieve was also revived and published in this 1796 chapbook. Saint Genevieve was especially well known among the Pennsylvania Dutch because her story and legend was a very popular one of virtue in the face of adversity. Saint Genevieve's story is that she was blackmailed by a member of her husband's court. She was a countess, and through this process of blackmail, her husband unfortunately believed the person who had told lies and rumors about her character, and she was banished to the wilderness, where she gave birth to a baby boy. Out of fear of starving, she befriended a doe who suckled her baby and kept the two of them from starving. And her story was one of a woman who overcame all sorts of adversity, who under normal circumstances would have gone to the wilderness to die, but who instead became this sainted persona who forgave her husband after having been cast out, and eventually, after her husband realized the error of his ways, invited her to come back. And it was a controversial legend in certain respects, because of course it stressed a number of different controversies associated with women's rights. But the fact was that among the Pennsylvania Dutch, this particular story was thought to be inspirational about what one could do despite heavy adversity. And she was yet again another female saint of the wilderness, living in isolation and thriving despite all adversity. These have echoes with the Mountain Mary legend as well. Another woman thought to be, in this case, a sacred authority, living in the Oley Hills, helping others out of the generosity of her heart, and serving as a model of righteousness and virtue for her community. This idea of Mary as a saint is not just something that spontaneously arose within her community, but something that also survives in some primary sources. For instance, one manuscript that we have in the Heritage Center collection is a ledger from Daniel Bertolet. Daniel Bertolet was a preacher, hymnist, poet, farmer, and Pennsylvania state senator. And on November the 18th, 1819, he recorded the death and burial of Mountain Mary. He said, "Today Mary on the mountain was buried. Lord help us, for the saints have been decreased. The deceased looked quite lovely and beautiful, and without doubt she has entered into rest." This entry is one of the very first known instances documented shortly after Mary's passing that indicates that she had already been venerated as a saint. Although it is clear that Daniel Bertolet had included this particular saint's reference as a biblical reference to, of course, the community of saints, or the sainthood of all believing persons within the Christian faith, the fact was that he was alluding to something a little bit more here, and that this particular passage was meant to describe feelings that people within the community had for Mary. Mary was buried in a small family plot at her homestead in Pike Township. Today, this cemetery is set off on the edge of a woodland, bordered by farm fields and pasture. It has a stone enclosure around the outside of it that we know through her estate papers was built following her death. She was buried with her mother and at least one of her sisters, possibly both of her sisters, based on Benjamin Hollinshead's recounting of his visit to her property. He mentioned her mother and sisters were buried there. There are four graves, and the interesting thing is one of her sisters had a connection to New York. There is some uncertainty about whether or not her sister passed away in Germantown, passed away in New York, or passed away in Pike Township at the property. We do know that there were three other women living with Mary in the 1790 census, and it is very likely that these four graves represent those four women who were living at the property at that time. This particular graveyard continued to be the site of pilgrimages after Mary's passing. Especially in the 20th century, community leaders banded together and formalized the practice. Folks had been visiting her grave to pay their respects to her as a community leader and legend for generations prior to this. But in the early 20th century, it was institutionalized. Members from the Hill Church community, members from the Berks County Historical Society, and many other civic organizations banded together to create a ceremony that would have speakers, songs, and poems that were recited. And this has been a focal point within the community of the Oley Valley for many years. The grave site is on private property, and I recommend that if anyone were to visit today, that they would check with the owners before proceeding to the cemetery out of respect for private ownership. It is one of the most beautiful places in Berks County, in my opinion, and one that has a sense of serenity that goes along with it that is befitting of the story of Mountain Mary. In Daniel Bertolet's ledger, there is also a Grabschrift for Mountain Mary. A Grabschrift is another word describing an epitaph or something that typically would have been read at the time of a funeral. His poem in translation reads, "Here under this stone softly rest the bones of pious Mary. Her heart and whole life were devoted to her God, as anyone could see from her way of life. Untiringly, she lived alone in solitude until 30 years had passed. The lines of her face revealed God's love, with which the Lord rewarded her. Yet even after her departure, one saw the sweet peace in her countenance, full of love and bliss, as always, directed towards the Son of Grace. Now she is taken away. God, call her unto thee from this valley of tears, where in the meadows of heaven she will behold Jesus amongst his chosen number." Central to the pilgrimage movement that took place in the early and mid-20th century was the altarpiece produced by Henry W. Sheridan of Kutztown. Henry W. Sheridan was the founder of the art program at the Keystone State Normal School, which eventually became Kutztown University. This altarpiece is currently in a private collection, and it features a central image of Mountain Mary, dressed as a late 18th and early 19th century woman carrying a basket of apples. There was a particular variety of apple that was attributed to Mountain Mary in the Oley Valley that was known as Good Mary's apple, according to some reporting done in the late 19th century in the community, following some of the interest that had accumulated around her legend. Many of the images that you can see on this triptych, which is a folding painting in three parts, on the outer folds there are images of the cemetery in both winter and in summer. And as it opens up, you see this central panel showing aspects of Mountain Mary's property, her agricultural activities, her attending the sick, and her carrying her produce and butter and cheese to market on her head. All of these different aspects of her story are woven into this rich tapestry of her life that was used to commemorate her story. Henry W. Sheridan used this as a visual aid during his presentations at the pilgrimages each year. Here is an image of Henry W. Sheridan in his studio. You can see him giving a short presentation on the significance of this particular altarpiece that he created in her honor. Pilgrimages continued throughout the 20th century, somewhat infrequently after the 1970s. I had the privilege of being able to lead one of these efforts in 2009 along with a few colleagues. This particular pilgrimage was an opportunity to bring people together. And what was very obvious to me was that we had many different generations joining in on this pilgrimage. There were some people there who had participated in pilgrimages long ago, in the middle of the 20th century. And there were others who were brand new to the Mountain Mary story. What I found was that there were many different sectors of society in the Pennsylvania Dutch cultural region who found interest and inspiration in the story of Mountain Mary, especially today, not only those who are seeking to understand their history and their roots, many people who are interested in the culture, the history, and the language, but also groups of people, young people, who are eager to explore Mary's story as part of their curiosity and interest in alternative spiritual modalities, for whom Mary is also a central figure. And this is one of the ways that we can see that Mary's story continues to be significant to a wide range of people, a wide range of religious expressions, and from one generation to the next. I'm delighted to be able to introduce Mountain Mary's story as part of our efforts here at the Heritage Center, honoring her life and legacy and the meaning of her story for the Pennsylvania Dutch community. I would like to invite you all to come out to the Heritage Center during our normal business hours, Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. until noon and from 1 till 4, to see the Mountain Mary exhibition entitled Mountain Mary Contemporary Visions of the Sainted Healer. Here you'll be able to see many different aspects of her story and tradition and the way in which continuing efforts by artists, storytellers, historians are continuing to keep Mary's story alive. This is an important aspect of our local culture, and one of the ways that we can also take a look at how the culture over the years has dealt with challenges, adversity, difficulties from the time of immigration up until the present day. And what we see, especially through Mary's story, is the way in which she exemplified the kindness, generosity, and persistence that earned her not only the veneration as a saint, but also as a folk hero among the Pennsylvania Dutch and the broader region of southeastern Pennsylvania.
Now ist die Zeit für unser Sprichwort von Monat, our proverb of the month. Die Maria Stund hat Gold im Mund, wer die verzeimt, geht zugrund. The morning hour has gold in its mouth, whoever misses it goes to ruin. This proverb encourages one to get up early to start your day by your own volition rather than wake up late and be dragged along by a world already set in motion. This proverb reflects an agricultural frame of reference when much work must be done before the rise of the sun, such as milking cows and starting the fire in the kitchen wood stove. Nevertheless, its message can also be taken to heart today, and perhaps not necessarily in reference to timing. Consider it a call to actively set your agenda for the day rather than be pulled along by others. A fresh start to your daily activities can be the perfect remedy during the hustle and bustle of the holiday season. Wel, liebe Gucke, zelis alles was mir hen heit. For the Pennsylvanish Deichstund, do on BCTV, ma wünsche euch allen Säge für die Feierdauer von her. Ma wünsche euch ein heiliger Grüßtag und ein glückseliges neues Jahr. Ma sehne uns nächsten Monat do on BCTV. Ohne Weils bleibt euch gesund und munter und mag's gut.